I couldn't have made this record without Eric. Eric Valentine was, my management had given me a box filled with CDs that covered most of the rock and roll records that had come out in the last almost 10 years, you know, like all these different bands, you know, trying to find a record that really stood out in my mind as being like a really great sounding rock and roll record. The best one in there was Queens of the Stone Age, Songs from the Deaf, or Songs for the Deaf. And then that was one of my favorite records, and Eric Valentine had done it. And then he'd also done Smash Mouth, which was like way on the other side of the, you know, on the other side of the spectrum. And All American Rejects. So I was like, this guy's got a diverse sensibility, which is exactly what this record needed. So I called him up and he came down and I gave him the 20 song list of demos, you know, or 20 song demo. And you know, he took it home and he called me up and he just, something in his tone said that he got it. He really understood what we were doing. And he had his own studio, which was a killer, funky old place in Hollywood. And he, you know, because he owned it, we weren't sort of like stuck to any particular schedule, because this was a hard record to totally know exactly which day you were going to be working and, you know, which day the singer was going to be there and all that kind of stuff. So we were flying by the seat of our pants. And so basically we started with, We're All Gonna Die with Iggy Pop, and just Eric Valentine's input totally understood where I was coming from, and anything he had to say to contribute ideas was totally in sync with what I was doing. It wasn't like some producers whose egos sort of take over the sound of a record in the process of making it and take it away from being actually the artist's record. So that was a huge blessing, and we both wanted to do it analog. So very cool. They play on every track with the exception of Watch This, which is Dave Grohl and Duff McKagan. And then there is a song called Starlight that Steve Ferrone played drums on because Josh was out of town. That was actually the second to last song on the record that we recorded. And those guys really made, Chris and Josh made the record really sort of painless. I mean, because all I had were a lot of makeshift demos, right? And that's what I was sending to singers and crossing my fingers and hope that they'd get it. And what we would do was just take this demo and just play it first thing in the afternoon when we got to the studio and then put the song together instrumentally that afternoon and have it done by 6 o'clock in the evening. You know? So those guys were phenomenal. All right, so this is the first single off of my new solo record. This is a riff from the song called By the Sword, and I wrote it with Andrew Stockdale from Wolfmother. Very beginning of it goes like this. And then it goes into the first verse, which is... about doing it on electric, there's two ways of doing it. There's the way I did it on the acoustic, which is, that's one way of playing it, and then I doubled it by going, it just makes it that much more solid. And the verse riff is basically the same. The only difference about that is that I did it with the verse with a wah-wah pedal. So this is the bridge section right before the guitar solo for By the Sword. First thing that I hear once I've actually got the chord structure down, I just go for it. And 9 times out of 10, that's exactly what's on the record. And I keep, so like if I go and play it again, I know what it sounds like. And, you know, I might, by the time I've done a couple takes, fixed a couple notes here or there that I hear. But this record in particular was almost what you call sort of demo love. Like all the sort of random first takes that I did making the demos were great. So I just sort of kept it within that theme. Oh, the original Paradise City is one of my favorite sort of Guns N' Roses moments when that song was written. It's one of my favorite Guns songs because it's heavy and it's nasty, but it's up-tempo and sort of in a positive kind of, you know, it's not all dark and Dungeons and Dragons and it, whatever, you know, so it's got this really sort of up-tempo, positive kind of vibe, but it's still raunchy and it's very nasty and it's got a kick-ass delivery. And when we wrote it, we were in a van, on the way back from a gig in San Francisco back to Los Angeles. And it started out with the actual chorus, you know, the chorus, the and it was one of those things where the melody came to the chords, and we were all in this van together. So started singing, you know, I think the words came around, and then eventually, you know, I came up with that riff, and it was just one of those songs that was totally the product of just really good times in a great camaraderie between 5 guys, and it was really cool, and it came together really quickly. It was all part of the moment, you know? It's a song sort of, as in most Guns N' Roses songs, especially on the Appetite for Destruction record, it sort of just wrote itself. And, you know, once everybody was jamming the chords and singing the chorus, and then that just came to mind. And there's not a lot of thinking going on, at least in the way that I do things. It's more sort of spontaneous, you know? Very sort of loose, you know, that's his way of loosely playing the main riff is always sort of in and around the actual notes. And then the part that I play is... just went with the part. That was one of Izzy's parts. Instead of using an octave pedal, which were actually few and far between back in the day, you know, there's a few sort of commonly known ones now, but and they just didn't sound that good. So what I did is just record both parts an octave apart. Yeah. So it's, you know, it's one of those. I thought that was sort of a cool way of doing it. There's a part of the solo where I do the same thing. So it's a little bit more genuine sounding. one of the interesting things about Guns N' Roses is a lot of the riffs that I write for Guns originally started out a little bit more driving, but as the, you know, sort of slower and more almost funky kind of thing. And then what happens as in all Guns N' Roses material, everything gets kicked up a notch, and that's just the way Guns N' Roses does. But I thought if I was going to redo the song, I was going to make it a little bit slower and a little heavier. When Duff and Matt and I first got together, we did this benefit gig for Randy Castillo at the Key Club. And the Cypress Hill guys were there, Steve Tyler was there, and we did Paradise City that night. And Cypress Hill guys did the verses, rapping it, and then Steve Tyler and a couple other people sang the choruses, right? I got a lot of grief for working with Fergie. Like all the sort of hard rock purists were like, dude, what are you doing? You know, cause she exemplifies pop music. But the thing was, is I'd heard her sing, a couple of years ago, I heard her sing, rock and roll, like amazing rock and roll vocals in, what's it called? This club in LA. And, she was doing a medley of Black Dog from Zeppelin, Barracuda from Heart, and, Live and Let Die from Paul McCartney, Guns N' Roses, however you want to look at it. And it was amazing. So, you know, I'm always on the lookout for good rock singers, as everybody knows. And, so that was one of those things where I sort of stayed in touch with her and did a few more gigs with her. And then she called me up and wanted to do Sweet Child of Mine at the Orange County Fair. And I was really sort of, you know, not sure about it, but I just knew she's got this amazing voice. So I went down there and we sound checked it, and it was just awesome. So, that point, I knew I wanted to do something with her. And since I was doing this record, I had this one song that I had actually penned for a score in a movie I was working on simultaneously with demoing the record. And it was, music was set to the strip bar with these girls dancing. And so that was the piece of music that I decided would be great for Fergie to sing. And she just came at me with this great lyric and great melody. And I think everybody will sort of get why I worked with her. The Paradise City solo, what happened was, you know, like I always tried to do all the guitar parts in one day and get it solo, rhythm parts, acoustic parts, whatever. And by the time we finished Paradise City in like the octave parts and just putting all that together, I remember I did the solo that night and was pretty petered out. And I was really bummed at myself that I hadn't captured the take that night. It's the first time on the record that I actually sort of run into that problem. And so the next day I came in and that was the first thing I did. And it was just a real, just brash attack. And I think we did it in two takes and put the two best parts together. I got a couple new pieces of gear coming out. And, the first one right here is a replica, a pretty exact replica of the guitar that I recorded Appetite with, and most of User Illusions, and all of my new record, and a lot of Velvet Revolver. And this was a guitar that I got literally the night before I went in to do overdubs for Appetite. I didn't have a decent sounding guitar. Alan Niven, our then manager, gave this beautiful 59 reissue that was hand built by a guy named Chris Derrick. Back then, Gibson didn't make reissues. So, anyway, it sounded amazing, and it became the guitar that I used for the whole record. And I took it on the road for the first year that we were out. And then I finally went to Gibson and had them, I bought two, 89 standards from them, or 88 standards for that matter, and, put the Dara guitar away. And it's been the source of, like the Appetite for Destruction record has become very iconic. You know, and this guitar sound that I had, and realistically that guitar and also the Marshall that I was using was the product of, that sound was the product of those two pieces of gear. So all these years later, there's this huge fascination with the equipment that I was using for that record. And, at this point I thought it would be really great to sort of recreate that guitar and all the hardware and the finish and that whole thing as a sort of homage to all the sort of diehard Guns N' Roses fans over the years. And so this is the model. This is the prototype that I finally signed off on and that we're going to start going with. And it comes out April 1st. And this is the USA model. And then there's also a custom shop model as well, which I have not seen yet. I'm waiting to see what that one looks like. And basically with this one, we have the old school, old school hardware as far as like the knobs, the bridge is the bridge is an old school sort of tone pro bridge. The pickups, these are the first Seymour Duncan slash model pickups, which are still Alnico 2 Pros, but they're wired exactly or wrapped exactly and using all the same hardware as the 86 ones. And they've evolved over the years. So we went all the way back and sort of recreated the 86 Seymour Duncan Alnico 2s. I can't take the plate off right this second, but we have old school capacitors in here, which is a really important factor in how this guitar sounds. And then the old school shallers and, and it's matched to that guitar in the same finish, which is a sort of honey flame top kind of deal, which, actually I think was really Chris's design. I don't think they ever made a top exactly like this as far as with flames and stuff in it. So that's basically how the guitar situation. And we're also working on the AFD 100 Marshall, which is, an amp that, if you go online, you can find all these people who have been trying to rebuild this particular, it was a 19, I thought it was a JCM 800 because I couldn't even remember, but it turns out it was a 1959, super lead head. And it was a rental that had been modded for, I rented it from SIR and it had been modded. And, it was out of a handful of amps that I rented that day. It just sounded the best, you know? And I tried to, the funny story about it was I used it for the record. It was the only amp that I used. And after the record was done, when we started rehearsing for the tour, I had stolen the amp and put it in storage. And I told my roadie at the time, I said, whatever you do, don't use that amp at SAR when we're rehearsing. Anyway, so I get to the studio and my amp's gone. I'm like, how come I don't have an amp? Because the SAR guys came and took it. I was like, why? I said, well, they said you took it from them. I was like, well, why did you bring it down? You know, anyway, it has not been seen or heard of since. And, even more than, you know, sort of like the fascination with the guitar, because the guitar I still have and it's more tangible, but this mystique about this particular amp has really just, it's worldwide. There's kids everywhere, you know, trying to figure out how the amp was wired, what the mod was, you know, everything about it and all the specs you can find in all these different blogs and whatnot. So I thought, to go to Marshall and let's recreate that amp and that sound. And we went and took, the raw guitar tracks off the Appetite for Destruction masters to really get a good idea of the exact sound. Cause we all know it from the record, but to like really be able to analyze it. And it's true. You know, if you listen to these raw guitar tracks, it had a really, really unique sound, you know? So that's in the process of being made and should be coming out sometime around April, May or something like that.